On Nationwide this evening, stories of people who have come to this country and who are integrating into Irish society. We meet students of a Waterford school where the ethos of support and integration has brought the school a best-in-class merit award for this work. Plus, the women who are doing their bit to bring support to mothers of young children who are in direct provision centres. You're welcome to Nationwide, where our programme this evening is all about Cade Mila Fáilte, the Irish Welcome. Over the last 20 years or so, many thousands of people have come from abroad to live in Ireland. This influx has largely been successful, particularly for those with skills who have found work and housing. All over the country, there are schools with many students whose first language is not English. These pupils have had to learn fast to keep up. Schools have been doing their best to support these young people, helping them to adjust. Later, we'll visit one such school in Waterford and hear all about the work involved. You're welcome back to Nationwide, where this evening we're looking at the welcome given to people who come to live here. Now, Places of Sanctuary Ireland is a charity designed to encourage and support communities around Ireland, providing assistance to those who have come to settle here. And last year, the organisation awarded Mount Sion CBS Secondary School in Waterford the accreditation of being the first school of sanctuary in the Republic. We went to visit. This is our sanctuary. We can find shelter and peace. This is our sanctuary. You are safe with me.
So to become a school of sanctuary, I suppose there's three very important principles, and that's learn, action and share. So the first step, I suppose it took us 4 years really, and the first step of the journey was learning and just educating ourselves on who was looking for sanctuary in our school, and knowing where the lads came from, what the struggles were at home, the reality of the situation. And then the action was sharing that within the school. We educated every class, just where the boys were coming, what the situations were, whether they're at war. Big difference between, I suppose, an EL learner that comes with mammy and daddy for work and has that support. And the lads that came from Europe have been to school, mostly Catholic schools, so there wasn't much of a change and they were doing well, but then there was a lot that weren't doing well because it was a totally new culture. So we, I suppose, learned about that within the school and then shared with the wider community. We went to the Earth Conference in Croke Park and we asked every Edmund Rice school to join us. We have had guest lectures with UCC, with UL, with everyone, and it's the boys themselves that share, you know, so it's been a lovely, lovely thing. You are safe with me. 37 nationalities here at Mount Sion at the moment that we know of, and it's just amazing to even be able to tell you. And people are always fascinated when they come to the school and say, how do you know where they're all from? And that's because we're interested. And we find out and they're all so proud of it. The early 2000s saw a big influx of migrants into Ireland, but they were Polish and Lithuanian. And then, I suppose, then we saw a lot of Croatians coming, but now it's non-Europeans, which is amazing. And they were in a whole other culture and diversity. Lots of people from Brazil, Sudan, Nigeria, Afghanistan. Yeah, it's amazing, isn't it?
Edmund Rice started exactly where I'm sitting, a school for boys who needed education. But now being a school of sanctuary means we have actually found our heart and our soul again. To be a school of sanctuary today for these boys is actually for us, we have found our mission again. We've never forgot our home base. We've always been that type of school. And these boys you're talking about, Waterford boys from streets around here, Barry Street, Connolly Place, Hennessy's Road, they're our ambassadors. They haven't surprised me because they are that type of boy, but they have been so welcoming. And it's something I knew that was there, but when you see it in action, it's actually overwhelming. It's beautiful.
So I suppose we welcome all faiths and no faiths. And that's the thing, it doesn't matter. We've learned a lot at the moment from our Islam students. So Friday is very important that they go to mosque. So they're released from class and they go for the prayer and they come back. It's Ramadan at the minute, so they have a box in my room, their mats are there. They come, we're all fascinated. They follow the compass, what way is the sun and what time is sunset, sunrise, and they pray. Halal food, we have school lunches and the school completion provides breakfasts and they're all halal now. We still go to the church, but it's now a celebration. And at every celebration and event, be it in the church or in the school, the lads can say a poem in their home language. They don't celebrate Christmas, so they tell us what they do instead.
Abdullah, where are you from? Syria, thank you, doing it for your country. What about you there?
Of course there's differences, so we learn about the differences, but we don't spend too much time on the difference, then we look at the similarities. At the end of the day, we are all people, and we all have a passion for sport, we all have a passion for music, maybe it's just a different thing. So we're all learning from each other, even knowing where, I suppose the geography must be much improved, knowing all these countries, knowing their flags, knowing where they're at. We can look at their food, we can look at their music, we can look at their art. The business class can look at the currencies, the different businesses, like there are endless possibilities to bring in their culture. And we're languages then, we're all known, I can say hello now in 37 languages. You know, it's just amazing how much we have to offer each other.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on.
Basically, I'm from Afghanistan. We lived in Baghlan, which is one of the cities in Afghanistan. I have 6 brothers and 2 sisters. They're all living here with us in Waterford, Ireland. But before that, there was like a war going on in our country, fightings, no education was available. There are facilities like schools. But when I came here, I literally start my life from scratch, building way up, like going to school, doing my education, trying to speak as much English as I could to improve it. And also it was a good opportunity for me to involve myself in many different activities as well as in Mount Sinai. And that really helped me to change my life.
It's a good opportunity for my children to do their education. Very less percentage of children over in Afghanistan have access to school. And I'm very happy for them that they got the opportunity to do their education and go forward in life.
My favorite thing to live in here in Waterford, that I'm in good school. I feel like more comfortable in here in this school and feel safe in the school.
I'm a School of Sanctuary ambassador and I joined last year. So I've been kind of here, one of the first people here, and I'm the only person who's born in Ireland who's a part of this. So my role for this is if there's students coming in, especially maybe newer students, just to get them familiar with their surroundings. At the end of the day, it's really just for students in need. You don't even need to be a refugee, you know, if you're part of the LGBTQ community or if you're part of the travelling community. If you're having a bit of, you know, trouble or anything, you can just come here and, you know, learning can be at your own pace. And it's really built a community in itself. Inside the school, it's really built a community that anyone can be a part of. There's no, you know, it's real carefree. It's really nice.
To fully engage any student, but especially newcomer students, you have to engage with the family and you have to provide support to the family. I suppose getting the parents to come to parent-teacher meetings, to come to school celebrations, they often were missing, but probably they didn't know they were invited. So we've seen a massive change there. And again, you're connecting with the parents in their language, so they're coming in more.
It was very good when I first met Miss Byrne, and she called me to chat about things. And you know, when you're feeling that it's something positive, it's something like you can say whatever you want to say because it will be sorted, it will be without any problem. So we chat about Krzysztof, how he's working, what he's doing in the school. So now I know better what is going there, which is the classroom where they are going for hours to feel good, to have any question, because he was very shy. And thanks God, like really he's open himself for me, for the school, for teachers, for Miss Byrne, for everybody. So it's a lovely thing.
I came here first. I was like not feeling safe because like I didn't know anyone. But over the like the months and the years, that got out of it and I feel safe.
So the partnership between ourselves here in the Manor Street Community Youth Project and the School of Sanctuary up in Mount Sion is so important to us. It's one of our key relationships with a really important place in our community where young people spend a lot of their time. It works through the relationship that we have with staff in the school. Narelle is an incredible champion for young people in the school. For us, they come down then once a week. We have their group on the day that they have a half day in school, so they literally come walk out of school and come straight down. And that's where the group started, so they're here for about 2 hours. Whatever they want to get involved in, so they make a plan for their group. We come in, have a chat. It's really important to get to know the young people. Education is one part of life, but being able to socialise with people they know. But also another thing that's really important is to be able to build relationships with other young people that they might not come into contact with through school or wherever else. So they have their core group, is what we call it, their weekly group. They come in, they use the games room, play pool. Music is a huge part of the group, so we bring their music into the space. So it's not just about them coming in and like taking the centre as it is, it's about making it their own as well. This is our sanctuary.
We can find shelter and peace. I've learned so much, you know. I won't say how long I've been teaching, I'm not that old. But you kind of can get complacent, you think you've seen it all. I'm sure I'm an Irish teacher, no bother to me, German teacher, no bother to me. But this is a whole other challenge, you know, and it's great to have. I've learned so much from them. Yeah, loved the journey.
And Mount Sion CBS Secondary School in Waterford is a role model, encouraging other secondary schools to follow suit. And so we've come to the end of this evening's Nationwide. Thanks indeed for watching, and from all of us on the team, bye-bye. But first this evening, we have the story of Irish mothers reaching out a hand of friendship and support to other mothers who have come to this country and who are now part of the direct provision system. Let's Match Mums is a social enterprise which helps mothers in direct provision by connecting them with families who have children of similar ages. I'm in Carrick and Shore with founder Louisa May Hanrahan to find out how it all works.
Tell me, Louisa May, what is Let's Match Mums all about and what need is it meeting?
Let's Match Mums, we connect mums in need of baby products and direct provision with local mums that can pass over their baby items. How it all began is I was running an organisation called Let's Help, or Let's Help Direct Provision on Instagram. And what we do is we run collection points where we bring needed items to asylum seekers in direct provision. We were doing a lot of these collection points and we were getting a lot of messages in from mothers, local mothers, offering such an amazing range of baby stuff that I knew mums in direct provision needed. And basically our team wasn't big enough to facilitate the passing over of these items. So the team got together and we had a think and we came up with a way of matching the mums together so the local mums could pass their stuff on to the mums in direct provision and help them out. But also mums, as you can see with some of the stuff, they go out and buy stuff to give to the mums too, just as you kind of give your friends a little baby gift.
And what about the other aspect of Let's Match Mums, you know, developing relationships between mothers and children?
Yeah, this was really interesting. So we gave the opportunity on both sides for mums to remain anonymous, so it just facilitated passing over the stuff. And not one mum either side has opted in to remaining anonymous. They on both sides wanted to develop connections with the mums that they've been matched to. You know, forming community and becoming part of your community when you come to a new country is so important for anybody. And mums really, you know, I'm finding they love to stick together and to help each other grow. So it's become a really important part of what we do. When we talked to the Irish Refugee Council and different organisations about setting up Let's Match Mums, this was the thing that they highlighted as being almost like as important as passing on the stuff. In order to be coming into Ireland as an asylum seeker, they find those integrations become much more successful if you can connect your community and get to know people in the area.
How many matches have you completed to date?
So we're actually just about to make our 100th match, which is something that's just, it blows my mind because, you know, there's 4,000 women in direct provision, and just to know that 100 of them are matched so far, it just feels like we're making great progress. And just to know that there's now 100 women that are connected and able to receive stuff is pretty cool.
And those women are all over Ireland?
Yeah, so we started matching down in Wexford first, and then Tipperary. We've just started on Dublin and Kildare. So we're slowly popping up all over Ireland. I think this car has seen more miles in the past year than it's probably seen in its whole life.
Nick Henderson is chief executive of the Irish Refugee Council, and he talks about how the effect that direct provision has, especially in the cases of children.
Children in direct provision, and in our experience and work, they face huge difficulties. There may be stigma, racism. While schools have, in our experience, been really welcome, there can be difficulty in participating fully in school life, trips and so on. And then also issues around space. You know, kids are living in congregated spaces. Parents may not be able to properly cook for them. They may have access to cooking facilities, but they may have to book them, they may have to be shared. And we know from being parents that cooking is such an important part of family life. Also issues around support and cost of living. You know, parents would receive around 38 euro, kids around 29 euro. But in our experience, particularly during the pandemic, that's just been insufficient for a decent or even reasonable quality of life. So a wide variety of challenges, but in our experience also, kids are really strong and resilient and have fortitude, and superficially at least, they're able to get through this experience. But we know direct provision as an institution doesn't have the best interests of the child at its heart, which is really problematic, and it's for all stakeholders to listen up and take action really as soon as possible.
Well, as we saw, one person who did take action was Louisa May. We catch up with her to hear her thoughts on the success of Let's Match Mums.
Did you ever think it would take off like this?
No, we honestly just started matching 14 mums. That was our first goal, was to get these 14 mums matched. And then we threw it out to our community of local mums, and they just thought this was like an amazing idea, and they jumped on board, and we were able to find mums nearby them to match them with, and it just started to grow very quickly from there. So we basically, you know, came up with the idea, put together a good pilot of it, and now it's come to fruition, which is wonderful to watch.
Toomey is a mother of three and a resident of direct provision. She was one of the early recruits to the programme and is now one of the organisers.
So how has Let's Match Mums been for people who are in direct provision? Already there are 100 matches.
Let's Match Mums has helped a lot of mothers in direct provision, because most of the mothers at the moment, they've been matched, and with their matches, they receive clothes, they receive baby formulas, they receive boogies, blankets, school uniforms, books, feeding bottles and stuff like that. Let's Match Mums, it has done a great job.
And there's a great need for women in direct provision to integrate more fully with Irish mainstream society. Is this a way to help that?
I mean, it helped me. It helped me a lot. And I think it's doing the same thing to other women. It makes them feel comfortable. It makes them feel that, you know, now they are well welcomed, and there are people that cares out there. They are not alone anymore.
Nearby, on the Kilkenny border, Bridget Harberlin is a mother of two who has signed up to pass on her children's clothing through the Let's Match Mums programme.
Let's Match Mums is just an ingenious idea, and it's so simple and it's so straightforward that it's a direct connection. It's different to other, like, I don't even see it as a charity. It's just, it's a dig out, it's a help in time of need. I suppose one mum knows what another mum needs, and it's a very simple concept. So I can go to the supermarket and buy two of something. buy two shower gels, buy two tubes of toothpaste. You know, it really doesn't add up to a whole lot. If I buy a few bits over a space of a couple of weeks and double up on things, like we all go to Pennies and we can buy t-shirts and pennies for €2 or €3, you know, throw an extra few in a basket. You know, it's very simple. And then I've got clothes that my kids have grown out of that are really good clothes that they just don't like. Again, that's more the privilege. They've got the best of everything and then they don't like something because it's a certain colour. And it's just lovely to be able to pass that on to somebody, really. And the way I view it is that it's almost like living in a prison with your children, and that your autonomy over your own life has been taken from you. And all you want is to be able to provide for your family and to be on €38 a week with two kids and told what times your meals are and what your food is. I really feel that we're so privileged here. We have no idea of the privilege that we have living in this country.
My children, on a daily basis, they'll ask me, Mummy, when are we getting our own house? Mummy, when are we moving to our own house? Mummy, but you said we're coming here to have a better life and stuff. Why are we living like this? It's so hard for me. On a daily basis, when I go to bed, I'm asking myself, I even pray to God, God, will this ever end? I just want to see a smile on my kid's face. It's hard.
Indirect provision. There is no choice. And to have your choice taken away is, in essence, to have your freedom taken away. And I just want to make a small little difference along the way. And it's given, like, I'm getting something from this too. And that's amazing. I feel good. And I don't feel like a hero or anything. Like, it's not anything like that. I just feel good.
But Let's Match Moms came through, and then it was able to assist most of the moms. And, you know, there will be a smile on kids' faces when they receive gifts, presents, you know, seeing your child having milk that you don't have to pay for and all those kind of things. It makes a difference.
Last year, the government announced plans to end direct provision and replace it with a new system involving state-owned accommodation centres run by non-for-profit organisations. The aim is to have the old direct provision centres close by the end of 2024.
Coming up after the break, we visit a Waterford school to find out how they've coped with teaching hundreds of students, many of whose first language isn't English. We'll see you shortly.